Good morning, Grace Church. How's everybody doing this morning? All right. Is everybody still hanging out by the donuts? Oh, okay. Go get them. Tell them to come inside. Amen. Where the Spirit is, there is freedom. Amen. Make sure you tell your neighbor, give you a little bit of room. We're gonna celebrate this morning, Palm Sunday, amen?
Yeah.
You guys are free this morning. And Father, we ask to be led by your Spirit this morning, Father. Removing any feelings, Father. Because this is my worship. This is my offering. Because in every moment, withhold nothing. I'm learning to trust you, even when I can't see it. Cause even in suffering, I have to believe it. Cause if you say it's wrong, then I'll say no. If you say release, I'm letting go. If you're in it with me, I'll begin. When you say to jump, I'm diving in. If you say to steal, then I will win. If you say to trust, I will obey. I don't want to follow my own ways. Don't chase feelings, Spirit. Oh, Spirit, lead me. It felt like a burden, but once I could grasp it, you took me further, further than I was asking. And simply to see you is what we know. Your fire fall. If you say it's wrong, then I'll say no. If you say release, I'm letting go. If you're in it with me, I'll begin. When you say to jump, I'm diving in. If you say be still, then I will win. If you say to trust, I will obey. Spirit leads me. Spirit living. Let's sing it out when all hope is gone. When all hope is gone and your word is all I got, I have to believe you still bring water from the rocks to satisfy my thirst, to love me at my worst. Even when I don't remember, you remind me of my word. I don't trust my ways or trade in my thoughts. I lay down everything, 'cause you're all that I want. I bend it on my knees. This is the cup you have for me. Even when thank you. it out this morning. I have to believe, still be wonderful, to satisfy my thirst, to love me at my worst, even when I don't remember. You remind me of my word. I don't trust my ways, trading in my thoughts. I lay down everything, 'cause you're all that I want. I landed on my knees, this is the cup you have for me.
Nothing else matters. Nothing in this world will do.
Yes, it's all about you, from my heart to the heavens. Jesus, be the center. It's all about you. Yes, it's all about you, from my heart to the heavens.
Center of our lives, Lord. Without you, we wouldn't be here today. Without you, some of us would already be dead and gone. But we're so thankful that you came into our lives. I don't know about you, but I remember, you know, this song reminds me so much of my early days when I first got saved, you know, when I was 19, 20 years old, and I would head over to the White Tank Mountain sometime by myself and just to worship God, spend time. Sometimes I would act like Moses. I'd climb the mountain, you know, see if I would see a burning bush or something. You know, you're young, you know, 19, 20, you're seeking after, you're hungry. You just, amen. One time I took one of my friends, it's funny, one of my friends from single at the time, and one of my friends, my mom had made burritos. You know, she always puts them in foil. And I used to have that 69 Impala, and that thing, man, it was a great car, but sometimes I was having some issues with the radiator and so forth. So I told my friend, it was, you know, girlfriend that I knew there, not a girlfriend, but just a girlfriend, you know what I'm saying? Anyway, so we were going to go to the, and we did, we went to the White Tanks, we went to the White Tanks to pray, and no, I'm serious. No, this is somebody that was older than me, okay? She was older than me, okay? Anyway, so we went to the White Tanks, and, okay, stop it, I'm trying to get something to drink. So what happens, I told her, hey, I got these burritos, and how are we going to warm it up? You know, because we're going to pray. But my mom had made some burritos, so I took the burritos. And so my radiator was heating up. So I got the burritos and I put them on the radiator. And warmed up the burritos while we were praying. Glory to God. But I remember, you know, one of the songs that I would sing when I was out there by myself in the White Tanks. I didn't see a burning bush. I didn't see, you know, I didn't come down with tablets. But I remember, you know, that song, you know, Jesus. Jesus, Jesus, there's just something about that name. Or I would sing, Jesus, name above all names, beautiful Savior, glorious Lord. That song would just, and that was one of my favorite, and I would just sing that over, just focusing on the Lord Jesus. Because that's what it was about. I was in love with Jesus. Everything else that I was doing, it was because I was in love with Jesus. My witnessing, my whatever it was, because I wanted people to know about my love for Jesus. I was in love. You know, when you ever fall in love and you tell people about that person, well, same way. I was in love with Jesus, and he truly is the center of our lives. In fact, remember the story, remember in the Bible, Jesus died in the center between two thieves. And I believe, you know, Jesus, he's the center of everything. Everything revolves around him. The Bible says, by him, everything consists because of him. He holds everything by the word of his power, and everything consists because of him. He's the center, and those thieves represent us. The sad thing is that one of the thieves ridiculed them. But the other one said, man, what's wrong with you? We're here. We deserve to die. But he didn't do anything wrong. And he looks at Jesus and said, Lord. Notice he said, Lord. So he acknowledged that Jesus is who he said he is. Lord, remember me when you enter, when you enter your reward. And Jesus said, this very day, you're going to be with me in paradise. Amen. Now notice, the thief didn't have time to get water baptized. Right? So I guess somebody could have gotten a bucket and just thrown him some water, like, I baptize you. Come on. He didn't have time to become a partner. In fact, I want you to become a partner of a local church. We have pizza with the pastors today after the second service, after this service. If you want to become a part of our body of Christ, a member, we have that available. But he didn't have time to do all that. But notice how simple that salvation was. Why? Because it's just he acknowledged, you are Lord. You are King. I can't save myself. You are Lord. And so those thieves represent us. Both of those thieves deserve to die and go to hell. But one chose to acknowledge that Jesus is Lord. That he is who he is. And put his faith in Jesus. And he went to be with the Lord in paradise, he said. Amen. Amen. And so you see how he becomes the center of the focal point of our lives. Amen. So there's only two people in the world, those that believe and those that don't. We're the ones that believe, and he's the center of our very lives. Never forget that. Why do you go to church? Because my wife made me. Or why do you? No, it should revolve because of Jesus. You should come because you want to worship Jesus, and you want to learn more about him and grow in him. Let's go back to the basics. Let's go back to the foundation of where it all started. Amen. When you feel like you've lost your desire to come to church or whatever else, go back to why are you here? It's because one day back in 1982, I was in my room and I realized that I needed a Savior. And I gave my life to Jesus in that bedroom, and it totally changed my life from that day forward. The skies was bluer, the grass was greener, and all of a sudden the love of God overflowed me, and all of a sudden I had a love for people, I had a love for God, I had a love for His Word. I devoured it. I fell in love with Jesus. Let's not forget that, because it's all about. Things will come, things will go, storms may come, but it doesn't change. Jesus never changes. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. Are you ready to take communion? Just wanted to encourage you on that. Always keep Jesus at the center and the focus of your life. Hallelujah. Thank you, my Father. Oh, hallelujah. I want to share real quick as we're going to take communion. A lot of times when we take communion, we always focus on healing, and that's very important. But when we take communion, also remember that when Jesus took the bread, He broke it and He fed 5,000 people. So those of you, if you have a need, if you have a financial lack in your life or whatever, I want to encourage you, when you take communion, believe God for your miracle financially. Because notice, that was a blessing, that was a provision. What Jesus was thinking about when He took the bread and broke it, He was thinking about Himself. When I do what I'm doing at the cross, I'm going to make provision. I become your Jehovah Jireh. I'm going to provide what you need. I'm going to become El Shaddai to you, the God that's more than enough. So when Jesus broke the bread, He was thinking, what I'm doing here, when I die, when I'm crucified, man, I'm going to provide for their redemption from their sin, also from what? Their lack and their poverty. You don't have to be poor anymore. You know, in fact, you know what? I'm sick and tired of the church being poor. And the poor mentality. I'm sick and tired of it. Because why? Because Jesus died so that we might be blessed. Jesus died not just for our sicknesses, not just for our pain, but He also died to provide for us so that we would be blessed. When I read my Bible, it says in Proverbs that wealth and riches will be in your house. Amen? Not bamboo sticks and... Come on. So if you're lacking this morning, you're believing God, some of you, all it takes is one idea and you can now become a multimillionaire. It just takes one idea. One idea. And you'll become a multimillionaire. Now, of course, is it for you to just spend it on yourself? No. To be a blessing to the kingdom of God, and yes, be a blessing to the family of God too. God will get it to you if He can get it through you. He don't care how much money you have as long as the money doesn't have you. Come on. So as we take communion, if you need healing in your body, great. But if you need provision, believe for it too. Father, let's say this. Heavenly Father, as I take the bread, thank You for my miracle. Thank You for blessing me with creative ways to make more income so that I can be a blessing to Your kingdom and to my family and to my loved ones. But I also believe in this miracle of Jesus' body being broken that brings me life, brings me health, and brings me prosperity. I am blessed because Jesus was broken for me. I am blessed in Christ Jesus. Amen. Go ahead, pray, partake. Go ahead, take the cup and say this, Heavenly Father. Thank You for the blood. The blood has redeemed me. The blood has delivered me. The blood has provided for me for every area of my life. You've made me worthy through the blood of Jesus. I am now righteous. I am holy. I am the temple of the Holy Spirit. So Lord, I begin to walk like I'm the temple of the Holy Spirit. I begin to walk like I'm righteous. I begin to walk like I'm holy. Because the blood has made me holy. And I thank You for it. In Jesus' name. Go ahead, partake. Amen, amen, amen. Well, there's a bucket coming by. You can put the rest in there. And why don't you go ahead and greet one another? Love each other in the Lord before you're seated. Amen. Good to see everybody in the house. Now, let me make this quick announcement while you're doing that. Next week is, of course, Resurrection Sunday. So make sure next week, all you that are working, that you park at the school, because we need the space. Amen? Because it's going to be a busy day next week. Hosanna in the highest. Praise God. Palm Sunday.
God bless everyone and welcome to Grace. On behalf of the pastors, we want to say thank you for coming. Do we have any first-time visitors here today? No? Well, praise the Lord. We're all here. Amen. Amen. Well, we've got a lot of announcements, so let me get to it right now. First of all, I want to let you know that the cafe is having a sale today, and they're having tostadas, rice and macaroni, salad, and a drink for $7. You can't go wrong with that. Tostadas are my husband's favorite meal, actually. And so, also, I want to let you know that on this coming Wednesday, we have the men's and the young adults at 7 p.m. Yay! And then Miss Patty's group, of course, on the 28th. Every Thursday, she has her group at her home. And if you go down there at the gate, they will lead you to where it's actually at. It's not at her home, but it's behind the club that they have there, and they'll direct you there. And then it's Good Friday on the 29th, amen, a day before Easter. And so Easter Sunday, invite your family. You know, this is the day that it's Resurrection Sunday, the day that we celebrate Jesus, amen? And the resurrection, you know, this is the day that he died and he rose again for us. Salvation. Amen. Get excited for that. So invite your family, invite your friends on that day. Also, anybody that is helping on that day, we're asking for you to please park at the school. There's going to be lots of families. This is the day that most people come to church. So we're asking you to please park. Anybody that's working, anybody that's helping, any volunteer, please park at the school. If we do see your car up in the front, don't get offended. If you have one of the ushers or one of the security guards lets you know, please go park at the school, okay? So let's go ahead and park at the school. Also, on that day, we're going to be having up in the front hot dogs. We're going to have cotton candy. We're going to have popcorn. We're going to have, you know, things taking place up there. For those that can't stay, you can grab your hot dog, you can grab your cotton candy, popcorn, but those that want to stay here and fellowship, it's going to be a great time. We also need volunteers for those that we need volunteers for the cotton candy machine. We need volunteers for the popcorn machine, and then we need also people that will help us tear down and put up a setup also. So I'm going to be passing around a board here, a volunteer sheet. Please help out on those days. We get really busy on those days, so we're asking for volunteers, and it's going to go around there, okay? And then I'm going to call up, where's Pastor Andrew?
Mm-hmm. Good morning, everybody. Couple of announcements. The first one you're seeing on your screen, our Grace security team is in need of some upgrades on our radios. As the facilities have expanded, our need for better equipment has expanded as well. So you can see up there on the screen, the ask is as follows. We're looking to purchase 10 portable radios. And the cost is $282. And for 10 of them, you're looking at about $2,800. And then we need new earpieces, some remote mics, and then an FCC license to operate these, let's just say, better and improved radios. That these radios that we have right now have run its life. So our security team is in need of all of the following. If you would like to contribute anything towards that, we would appreciate your help for that. We're looking at a goal of about $4,000 for all this equipment. We don't want to buy anything cheap this time, and we want it to last. So it's going to be an upfront cost, but we're hoping to get at least 7, 8, 9, 10 years out of these portable radios that we're going to purchase. So that's the goal. We would love to see some help with that. Okay. The second, this is for the men. On Friday, April 12th at 6 p.m., two, 3 weeks, we're going to have a gathering out here in the back, similar to what we did about 2 or 3 months ago. We had a cornhole, we had some ping pong, we had some games outside, and then we had a short devotional. The theme is, in terms of the food, is you bring your own pizza. So bring a small or a medium-sized pizza from your favorite pizza place. Eat pizza you would eat, and then some pizza that you would be willing to share. And then I'll have a sign-up sheet later on. We'll get everybody to donate some other things, okay? So that's Friday, April 12th. God bless you. Thank you.
Then the last thing for today is we're going to have pizza with the pastors today. Anybody that signed up, remember, right after service today, we're going to be meeting at the youth building. And for those that did not sign up and would like to sign up, we're asking that you just come. It's going to be at 12:30, right after the second service. We're going to meet at the youth building. We have pizza, we have pop, we have dessert, we have different things. And I'm going to call up Pastor, and he's going to...
Is that the last announcement?
Uh-huh, this is the last. Uh-huh. He's going to share a little bit about it.
Amen. Yes, so if you didn't sign up, just come on over. It's basically becoming a partner with the church, or if you've heard of membership class before, and it's just hooking up with the body of Christ. And like I've stated before, everything that happened in my life, that's gone through my life, is because of my involvement in the local body. I'm at where I'm at today because, why? My connection with the local body. And that's where, you know, so it's so important. That you get involved. So it's free. Like I said, you don't have to give the pizza back if you don't become a partner, and you can keep it all to yourself and enjoy it. Amen. But anyway, so you know, we won't try to take too long of your afternoon. But if you're interested, you want to learn about our vision, what we're about, you want to become a partner, just go to the right after service to the youth building, and we'll have that for you. Amen. Listen, are you ready to give this morning? Raise your hands. The ushers will get you an envelope. A few people are ready to give. Otherwise, are thinking about it. But just raise your hands, and then the ushers will get you an offering envelope. Listen, I want you to go to Proverbs 11. Can you change the background on that? I want to go to Proverbs 11. I want to share with you a scripture before we take up the tithes and offering. I thank God for you guys because you guys are faithful givers. And I appreciate all the giving that you do. And that's what helps us to do what we're doing. Amen? Proverbs. Proverbs 11, 24 and 25. 24 and 25, I think is it? Yeah. Notice what it says. There is one who scatters, yet increases more. That doesn't make sense, does it? Somebody's giving out, and it says, yet they get more. See, to the natural mind, it doesn't make sense. They're like, I keep, you know, they think, well, if I keep giving, I'm not gonna have any more money. No, it says they're scattering, yet they increase. Listen, and there is one who withholds more than is right, but it leads to poverty. In other words, they hang on to it. Now check it out. They're hanging on to it because I'm saving, I'm hanging on to it, yet they don't have enough. In the natural, it doesn't make sense, but that's because that's natural. But when you come into God's kingdom, you operate on a higher authority. In God's kingdom, you operate in a higher authority, right? Notice, the generous soul will be made what? Come on. So in other words, what he's saying, it seems like you're losing when you're giving, but that's not true. You're actually going to get more back. It will come back to you. It just keeps coming. Amen? It just keeps coming back. You think you're losing, but you're not. Because what? What you sow will end up coming back. Pressed down, shaken together, running over. So that's a principle of the kingdom. You can never, never, never outgive God. The generous soul will be made what? Rich. And he who waters will also be watered himself. Have you ever done that? Throw a water balloon at somebody? What happens? You get a water balloon back, right? That's you know what I'm saying? He who waters will be watered himself. In other words, when you give of yourself in the natural, it seems like you're losing, but you're not losing. You actually gain more. Listen, it's true with the things of God, with the Word of God. Pastor John's going to come up here and teach you something. But listen, you know when you're going to get more of that word that he teaches you? When you give it out. When you speak it out and talk about it and share it with somebody else, you actually get more than what you give. Amen. See, that's why you don't understand. When I'm up here preaching, teaching, I get more out of it than you do. It waters me. I get more. The more you speak about it, it comes out of your mouth, it becomes more real to you. So, amen? So, as you give, understand, you might feel like you're losing, but you're not. You're actually gaining. You're actually gaining. And it's going to come back to you, and you're going to become what? More blessed and more rich. That's the promise of God's word. See, the world will tell you differently. The world will tell you, no, you know, save all you can and put the lid on top of the can. Right? You know what I'm saying? Get all you can, save all you can, and put the lid on the can. Don't nobody touch it. No. The Bible says put God first. If you'll put God first, then the rest will be blessed. Why? Because it's a picture of Jesus. You put Jesus first, and the rest of your life is blessed. He was the firstborn from the dead. He was the first one to die. He was the first one. Come on. It's all about Jesus. He first paid the price, then everything else. It's just a symbolism. So it's basically what you're saying is, God, I'm giving you this part, and he sets the rest apart. So what you give, that percentage, now it makes the rest holy. It sets it apart. Well, amen. Enough. You're getting too excited. Let's pray over the offering. I'm telling you, I'm speaking you the truth. Amen. Amen? That's why, listen, did you know that coming to church on the first day of the week, there's a symbolism there? Why did God choose Sunday to rise from the dead? Symbolism. It's the first day of the week. You're putting God first by coming to church. And guess what? I believe the rest of your week is blessed. It's on that same principle. Amen? I don't have time to go to church. You don't have time not to go to church. You know what I'm saying? Again, you're sowing. And God, you're going to reap extra time when you think you don't have extra time. Father, thank you so much for the opportunity to give again this morning. Thank you for the faithful giving of your people, Lord God. And we just thank you, Lord, as we're putting you first in our giving, that you are what? Blessing and sanctifying the rest of our finances so that we're blessed and everything that we touch, everything that we put our hands to is blessed. Not because of the Midas touch, but because of Jesus's touch. We are blessed and we thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen. Go ahead, ushers, you can receive it. I'm going to go ahead and have Pastor John. He's going to finish ministering to us what he began sharing last week. God bless.
Yes, I believe I do. Amen. Thank you, Pastor. Amen. Praise the Lord. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Amen. All right. Trying to get ready here. All right. All right. Very bad.
It's all right, I'll start yelling, glory to God, hallelujah. Jesus didn't need a mic, glory to God. But I ain't Jesus, so glory, that's a whole different thing. Amen, God is good, God is good, God is good. Everybody looks very nice, beautiful, amen. Looking good in church, all right? Turn to somebody and say, you look good in church, amen. Amen, amen. I do want to send a special shout out to my father-in-law. Rick Pacheco is here. Today would have been his anniversary. It is his anniversary. Glory to God. I know Sister Nellie is not my mother-in-law. Nellie is not here anymore, but he is, and I'm still blessed. Amen. I'm so blessed. They're a blessing to me. Amen. Glory to God. God is good. Amen. How's everybody doing? All right, good. Well, let's pray and we'll get into the word. Father, we just thank you, Lord God. We thank you, Father, for who you are, Lord, what you do, Father God. And most of all, Lord, we're thankful for your precious word, Lord God, that teaches us, guides us, leads us, directs us, Father God. And Lord, I just give you all glory and all honor. Holy Spirit, just have your way in this place today, Holy Spirit. As you just minister to our hearts, speak to us, Lord God, reveal things to us, Lord. And we thank you, Father. We thank you. We thank you. We thank you in the mighty name of Jesus. And we all said, amen, amen. Amen. Well, looking at the time there, all right, I know where we're at. Amen. It is a blessing. You know, I come to find out that, you know, doing two services isn't easy. So I tip my hat to Pastor because he does it every Sunday, you know, because sometimes I started realizing last week, I kept saying, but I didn't say that in the second service. I said it in the first service because I thought I said it in the second service, but I said it in the first service and I didn't say it in the second service. So maybe that's why it didn't make sense that I said this because I didn't say it in the second service. See, I got kind of like, man, what the heck did I do? What was I thinking? Because I think I've only done two services, just being here recently, and I know with Pastor David we did it a couple of times, but I've never really done, you know, two services like this. And I mean, I like it. Don't get me wrong. I like it and stuff, but you got to know what you're doing. Glory to God. Amen. So if I start preaching about something that don't make sense, it's because it's a second service. You should have been here in the first service. Glory to God. I'm not... just kidding. I even broke out my dancing in the first service. I'm not going to do it in the second because we're on camera. Amen. So if you weren't here, you missed it. Amen. Glory to God. Amen. Well, God is good. God is good. God is good. Amen. You know that I was talking about, you know, the battles of the flesh. And, you know, today is just part two. I'm just going to finish up on what I was talking about. And how many of you went home and really thought about it and said, man, I hated that message. I hate when people tell me what's wrong with me. I hate when somebody tells me I'm my own worst enemy. Because how many of you know that the greatest enemy for us is our own flesh? Amen. You know, I said this last week, and I don't know if I said it on the second, I don't know. But I said this, that, you know, that we, a lot of times we like to blame the devil for everything. We like to blame the devil. If we do something wrong, it was the devil. He made me do it. It was the devil. It was the devil. And the devil's even all quiet. The devil's like, I didn't do anything. I wasn't even there. Amen. I wasn't even close to you. Amen. But why is it though? It's because we hate to look at ourselves and look at our shortcomings. Okay, I gotta preach to the choir. We do, we really do. We don't like it. You know how sometimes they say, hey, you know, he was preaching, he was stepping on our toes, he was doing. No, you know what? Sometimes we need to hear those things. We need to hear those things. Why? Because I don't know about you, but I want to grow in the things of God. I don't want to stay the same way. I don't want to stay in the same struggles. I don't want to be doing something over and over and over again and not have not figured out a way to stop doing these things. Amen? And so when we start looking at what the Word of God says and what God is doing in our lives, and sometimes when we don't, you know, when we look at ourselves and we see, man, you know, I'm still dealing with this, you know, I'm going to tell you something. You're okay. You're dealing with it. There's a difference between doing it and not dealing with it. You just keep doing it. But when you're dealing with it, that means you know what's going on and you're making an effort to make a change. Because, I mean, you know, change isn't easy. You know, we hate to change. We want to stay everything. We want everything to stay the same. We want everything to stay the way they are. When things are good, we want it to stay that way. But I mean, you know, things change. Amen. And so we got to change in our walk with God. That's the biggest thing. There's always change in our walk. I don't know how long you've been walking with God, how long you've been serving God, but I'm sure you've gone through a lot of change. And I'm here to tell you, you're not done. You're not done. We're never going to be done. Amen? Change is going to be something we're going to be doing as long as we're walking here on earth. Amen? Amen. Don't sound too excited, but that's all right. Glory to God. God is good. I read some of these scriptures last week, but I'm just going to go and real quick over it. Romans chapter 8, verse 1 through 4. In the New King James, it says, There is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has made me what? Free from the law of sin and death. For what the law could not do, in that it was weak through the flesh, God sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh, and for sin, condemned sin in the flesh, that the righteousness of the law might be fulfilled in us who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. Amen? See, so we see here that he's telling us that we got to walk after the Spirit, not after the flesh. Amen? But how many of you know, sometimes it's hard to say no to the flesh? I'm telling you, you guys are so spiritual, man. Everybody in the first service, amen, amen. Yes, that's me, everybody in the first service. Second service, you guys got it going on, and you're like, ah. You're on camera. I know. You're being watched, amen. See, but see, Paul right here was just revealing who our worst enemy is. And it's usually ourselves, you know. We usually beat ourselves when we don't do things right. We beat ourselves when we're not, at where we think we should be at. Amen. Like if you've ever struggled, you've done something that you know in your heart you did the wrong thing. You knew as soon as you said it, that something in your spirit said, no, you shouldn't have said that. Something inside of you right away, like, you know, I shouldn't have done that. I shouldn't have said it. I shouldn't have gone there. I shouldn't have done. You know, there's many, many scenarios on that. But there's something inside of you that all of a sudden, as soon as you did it, that's just said, no, no. And sometimes you'll hear it inside of you tell you, go back and apologize. And your flesh is saying, I ain't going over there and apologizing. I was right. We start arguing with God. Why? Because our flesh doesn't want to humble itself and say, hey, I'm sorry. I'm sorry. You know what we want? We want the other person to come and say, you were right and I'm wrong. I know I was right and you were wrong. That's what we want to do. Amen? because we do not like to be confronted with ourselves. We're good at confronting other people, but we don't take it well when it's ourselves. Amen? When somebody looks at us and says, hey, you're wrong. What do you mean I'm wrong? See, we got to deal with the flesh. We're the ones that have to do it. You can't look at your spouse. You can't look at your kids. You can't even look at the pastor and say, you have to do it. Amen? We're going to see that. We talked about this last week. See, we deal, you know, we call it the flesh, the enemy here, the way Paul was describing it. You know, it's the body of sin. And we say, we don't, you know, I don't sin. We don't want to sin. You don't want to sin. You don't want to commit sin. I don't think too many people really wake up in the morning and say, I'm going to sin today. It's going to be a sinful day today. I'm going to have so much fun sinning. I'm just going to do it. Have a ball. No, we don't do that. Usually, a thought arises in our mind. A thought, all of a sudden, it's Friday. I just got paid. I got money in my pockets. You know, just thoughts of things, you know, of doing something you haven't done in a long time, that it was something you wanted to get out of. Why all of a sudden do I want to go back to it? Why do I want to go back to what I cried to God to get me out of? Why do I want to go back? See, but the thought isn't telling me about when I was crying now. The thought is only telling me about when it was fun. That's it. Remember how fun it was? Remember how great? Remember? You were there. Remember? Yeah, I remember. See, Brother Cecil remembers. He remembers. He was a member. When we had the men's home, we used to have a men's home. And the men's home, you know, these were guys that were out in drugs. And then all of a sudden they were there in the home and they would stay there, you know, up to 6 months to 9 months or however long they could handle it, because it's not easy being in a men's home. It's not. And so they were in there, but they loved to tell war stories. They loved it. Like, oh, well, I used to do this. You know what it was? It was their flesh crying out. It was their flesh still wanting to do that. It was their flesh trying to show off to somebody else, like, this is what I used to do. This is all the things. But this is the struggle about those type of things. There's such a good, there is a thing about a testimony about what God brought you out. But if your testimony, you're bragging about what you were doing, there's something wrong. The testimony is what God pulled you out of and set you on the right, you know, on His. And so when the men started doing that, I'd always try to cut it off, like, all right, I don't want to hear your war stories because you're scaring me. These guys are scary. These guys did crazy stuff, and I didn't want to hear it. Amen. I don't know, you know, sometimes I sat with some of these guys that were in the men's home and they started telling me about the things they used to do. I was like, my God, what are you doing in this home? You know, you should be in prison, you know, you didn't need to be locked up. But God is merciful. It's an amazing thing. But again, I started recognizing that what they're dealing with is their flesh, because their flesh was still crying now because, like I said, they're remembering the good things about it, not the bad things about it. Nobody ever remembers waking up all sick. Nobody, it's not like something you say, ooh, I'm going to go so I can get up sick tomorrow morning. I'm going to do these drugs so I can get sick tomorrow, so I can be out on the streets again, so I can be homeless, so I could be struggling, amen? So I can be, no, nobody does that. All this is, wow, it felt good. Flesh. That's all it is. That's all it is. And if we're not careful, we'll allow ourselves, because all of a sudden we start picturing in our mind of us doing those things, the fun things. And if you're not careful, you're watching a movie inside your head where you're the star. A star is born. You're cool. You're out there. You're doing this. You're doing that. Because why? It's because our flesh is crying out for those type of things. Amen? Why? Because your flesh, it's the same one you were born with. It's the same one that's been with you since day one. Even until you gave your life to the Lord, your flesh didn't just go away. Your spirit is what became new inside of you. Amen. That's what became new. But here God is saying, hey, you can overcome these sins. You can overcome your flesh. He's telling us, you know that there's gravity right now. That's why everybody is on a chair. If I jump from right here, I'm not going to float up. You know, I'm going to go straight down really quick. Amen? I might think I might fly, but it's about that fast because I'll be right on the ground. Why? Because there's a law of gravity. But there's things that you can do to defy the law. That's why these jets at Luke Air Force Base, they're flying out today. They got Luke days today. We might hear them pass by. They're out there flying. There's gravity, but you look at them jets. I don't know. I don't see no gravity, but it's because of the thrust, because of everything that's in there, all the power that's in there. It's the same thing. Gravity didn't go away. It's still there. It's just like us. Our flesh didn't go away, but the Spirit of God is inside, overcoming those things, that we can override the flesh and do what we got to do. Amen. When we start learning these things and start recognizing, it is so much easier to deal with the flesh, because it's easy to say, oh, the devil's attacking me, the devil's this, the devil's doing all this. You got to understand, the devil is defeated. He's got no power over you. He's got no authority over you. Amen. He's under your feet. Amen. He doesn't even have teeth. It says that he goes around as a roaring lion, but he's got no power. Only power he has is if I give it to him. I have to give it to him. He can come, he can do whatever he wants, but if I take my place, my stand, my authority, he's not going to do anything. I have bigger battles than dealing with the devil. My biggest battle, dealing with myself. Myself. Me, myself, and I. Now, go to Romans chapter 6, verse 12. Romans 6 in the TPT. I'm going to read it. Wow. Time's going fast. Romans chapter 6, verse 12, verse through 14, it says, sin is dethroned monarch. Sin is a dethroned monarch. So you must no longer give it an opportunity to rule over your life. Look at what it says. You must no longer give it an opportunity to rule over your life. You must no longer. See, it's telling us right out the start. It's got to be you. That you no longer give it an opportunity to rule over your life, controlling how you live and compelling you to obey his desires and cravings. So then, refuse to answer his call to surrender your body as a tool for wickedness. Instead, passionately answer God's call to keep yielding your body to him, as one who has now experienced resurrection life. You live now for his pleasure, ready to be used for his noble purpose. Remember this, sin will not conquer you, for God already has. And when you say sin, see, a lot of times we think like, oh, I'm going to go commit adultery. I'm going to go do this. I'm going to go do that. No, sin, just your flesh. Amen? It says, you are not governed by law, but governed by the reign of the grace of God. So what is it telling me? It's telling me that I have the control over this. Amen? I might miss it, but I'll recognize it. I might still do the wrong thing, but I'll know it. Does that mean, well, I might as well do it again and again and again? No. If I'm going to let God control my life, if I'm going to serve God and let God do who let God be who's God in my life, then this is what I have to do. I'm the one that has to make the change. I'm the one that has to say no. Amen. I'm the one. How many of you in grade school used to get paddled? Some of you got it. Some of you got it good. But here's the thing. How many of you learned the first time and said no more? No. Because you kind of thought like, yeah, well, I took it the first time. I might as well do it again. Yeah. I'll never forget. I mean, we had like six guys in grade school. We were like in fifth grade, and they were going to spank all of us. And one of my friends was already crying. It wasn't me. It was my friend. He was crying. He was crying, and my other friend kept telling him, shut up. Shut up. They haven't even hit you yet. They haven't even done anything to you. And it was the funniest thing ever because, you know, he was one of those like, no, no. He kept putting his hand out like this. And the principal, he was a big guy. I don't know if you remember Mr. Mulkey. He was an art teacher. And he was like, he was the art. He wasn't even the principal, but it happened in the art room. So he was like, like he was just ready. And I'll never forget because they kept telling me, if you put your hands, we're going to hit you again. We're going to do it again. And he kept putting his hand and whack, slapping me like, ah. But then when they're going to hit him again, no, he kept putting his hand there. But he didn't learn. Still did it again. Still went and got spanked again. But here's the thing, church, and I remember this. I clearly remember this. By the second, third time, he wasn't crying no more. He already knew. Pah! That was it. If we're not careful and we don't deal with the flesh, the things of the world just doesn't bother us no more. It's like, come on. Crucify the flesh. Just say, no, you ain't going to do it. I'm not going to do it no more. I'm not. I don't want this no more. Amen? We got to do our part, church. Amen? In James chapter 4, verse 1. What time we got? All right. James, there's pizza waiting. So James chapter 4, verse 1. See, and if you're not getting eating pizza, they got tostadas over there. Glory to God. James chapter 4, verse 1 in the TPT, it says this. What is the cause of your conflicts and quarrels with each other? Doesn't the battle begin inside of you as you fight to have your own way and fulfill your own desires? How many of you like to lose an argument? No, you don't like to lose an argument. You want to win the argument. Have you ever gotten mad? I mean, you know how they say like that when you get a wife, you get a driver's ed instructor for the rest of your marriage. I love that. Oh, you're driving too fast. You're driving too close. You're driving too little. She's an expert driver. I don't know. I just get lost because I'm also concerned about how I'm driving. That the next thing, you passed it like 2 miles over there. All the time. Honestly, before GPS, I used to get lost everywhere. I'd be driving. Where are we going? Oh, Pastor Ruby would look at me like, oh my God, not again. You know me. Scenic route. Let's go watch the area. Glory to God. We're going to get there. We're going to get there. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Have patience. Have patience. God is showing you patience. No, he's showing me that you don't know how to drive. Amen. But here, I talked about this last week, I believe. So I hope you heard this. If you didn't, well, glory to God. But what I want to get to is this. Go to Romans chapter 8, verse 5, in the TPT, verse 5 and 6. It says this, those who are motivated by the flesh only pursue what benefits themselves. You just care about me, myself, and I. But those who live by the impulses of the Holy Spirit are motivated to pursue spiritual realities. For the sense and reason of the flesh is death, but the mindset controlled by the Spirit finds life and peace. What sounds better, sin and death or life and peace? Life and peace, amen? So I got to allow myself that I'm gonna do what God wants me to do. I'm going to follow after God. Sure, I might miss it. Sure, I might, fail. But that does not give me an excuse to give up. Just because you had a bad day does not mean you need to give up on God. It might not be the only bad day you have. You might have another one, but glory to God. God is still God. God is still King. Amen. And if you just get up and keep going forward, keep serving God, keep loving God, keep doing what you know what to do, God is there with you. Amen. We got to learn how to get up. We got to learn how not to allow ourselves to condemn ourselves, to stop ourselves. Amen. Because we go through things in our life, the worst thing is, I've always said this, that I used to have an issue of how people saw me, like the way people saw me. And I kind of think like, I didn't want them to think I was weak. I didn't want them to think. And honestly, I don't care what people think anymore. Amen. I don't. So whatever you think of me, keep it to yourself. No, because you know that anywhere you're at, if you're not careful, let's say at your job, and somebody comes to you and they say, hey, you know what they were saying about you? No, I don't want to know. But tell me anyway. I don't want to know. I don't care. I don't care. I'm just doing my job. I'm doing what I'm supposed to be doing. But then if you do hear it, that they're saying, he's doing this, he's doing that and stuff, it'll mess with you. You'll think like, man, you want to change for what? For that person? Or do you want to change for God? Okay, if I am doing the wrong thing, then God will show me what it is. And God will help me with it too. Amen. If I need to make a change in my life, it's because God is showing me. Yes, somebody might bring it up, but here's the thing. Okay, they brought it up. It's been presented to me. I got to look in the mirror of God's word with it. And if it's on me, then I got to make a change about it. Amen. Not take it out on them. Not all of a sudden take it out on them. Why? Because my relationship with God is more important to me. Amen. If somebody does not like you, they don't like you. God loves me. It's all that matters, amen? Doesn't mean I'm going to do something just because you don't like me. I'm not going to talk to you. Well, So we're going to see something. See, because the flesh can only produce flesh. Amen? And flesh is a temporary thing. And sometimes when we get impatient, we try to make it happen in the flesh instead of waiting on God. Go to Galatians chapter 4, verse 22 through 24. I believe it's in the King James, the New King James. Galatians 4, verse 22. It says, "For it is written that Abraham had two sons, the one by a bondwoman, the other by a free woman. But he who was of the bondwoman was born according to the flesh, and he of the free woman through promise." Amen? See, here's the thing right here, and the reason I'm bringing it up is this. Is a lot of times we want God's promises, the word of God, we want those things to come to pass, and sometimes things don't happen the way we think it should happen. Sometimes things don't happen as quick as we want it to happen. Sometimes the change doesn't happen, and there's many, many things. I don't know. God's the one that's got the timing down to it. It's not our timing, it's His timing. Amen? God's never late. God's always there. Amen? God's on time. So when we're dealing with something here, Abraham was told he was going to be the father of many nations. But Abraham was saying, "I don't even have a kid. How am I going to be the father of many nations?" And God showed up to him and told him, "You and Sarah are going to have a baby. You're going to have a son, a firstborn." And they said, "Okie dokie, we're going to have one." But they never had one. Years were going by and nothing was happening. So all of a sudden, Abraham's getting older and older and older, and so is Sarah. And Sarai, at that time, she was getting older too. But here in Genesis chapter 16, verse 1 through 6, it says, "Now Sarai, Abram's wife, had borne him no children. And she had an Egyptian maidservant whose name was Hagar. So Sarai said to Abraham, 'See now, the Lord has restrained me from bearing children. Please go in to my maid. Perhaps I shall obtain children by her.'" I mean, you know, not a good idea. "And Abraham heeded the voice of Sarah and said, 'No, we will wait for God to do it.'" No, Abraham said, "Okay." Mm-hmm. Yeah, Abraham was like, "You sure, Sarah? You sure? You sure?" "Ah, none of these husbands would do that. I know you guys." And Abraham heeded the voice of Sarai. Then Sarai, Abraham's wife, took Hagar, her maid, the Egyptian, and gave her to her husband, Abram, to be his wife. After Abram had dwelt 10 years in the land of Canaan, so he went into Hagar, and she conceived. And when she saw that she had conceived, her mistress became despised in her eyes. Then Sarai said to Abraham, "My wrong be upon you. I gave you my maid into your embrace, and when she saw that she had conceived, I became despised in her eyes." So she's basically saying, "Abraham, the Lord judge between you and me." So Abram said to Sarai, "Indeed, your maid is in your hand. So do to her as you please." And when Sarai dealt harshly with her, she fled from her presence. So we see here the story, and we know they had the boy, Ishmael, and here's the thing. See, They got impatient waiting on the promise of God, and they did their own thing. It was a flesh thing. It was something they wanted to make something happen that only God was going to do for them. And see, if we're not careful, church, we will want to do something in our own flesh. Because I've heard people say, I'm bored serving God. I'm not happy. I'm not this doing things for God. I'm not, see, and my thing is, I think you're doing it the wrong way. Amen? Because there's joy in serving the Lord. There's peace in serving the Lord. Amen? There's so many benefits of serving God. Amen? We're never going to be perfect, church, but glory to God, the perfect one is inside of us. Amen? And he's helping us. Here we see Abraham, and if you look, all of a sudden, they did what they thought they needed to do, and it was in the flesh. All it did was cause more problems in the home. When we try to deal with issues in our own body, in our own flesh, oh, yeah, we make a mess of it, church. We make things worse. We make more problems in the house. Amen? I'll never forget, I had this member, this couple, they would come to our church, and one day I was ministering along this line, and after the service, she came up to me, and with tears in her eyes, she was crying, and I had never seen her cry, really, and she tells me, Pastor John, she goes, I don't want to complain about her husband. She said, I don't want to complain about him, but she goes, I want to hit him. He drives me crazy. And I said, why? What's going on? And he goes, because every time we're coming to church, he's mad. He's in the car and he's all moody. He doesn't even say nothing to me. And we drive over here to the church, and then he gets off the car and he's greeting everybody. He's hugging everybody, but he doesn't even do that for me. And I remember hearing her, and so I felt bad. I was like, oh, my God, what's the matter with you? And so I did. I ended up talking with them. I ended up meeting with them, and I talked to them. And right away, he didn't deny it. He didn't even argue. He goes, yeah. He goes, I know I do that. He goes, I know I do that. He goes, I'm not trying to do it, but I know I do it. He said, because Sunday's my only day off. I work 10 hours a day, and he works out in the hot sun, you know, and then he says, and I also work on Saturdays. They're always calling me at home. Sunday's my only day off, and I have to come to church, because he was one of the ushers, and I got to come to church. And I remember I told him, I said, well, you know what? You don't have to, usher. I said, you don't have to? I said, you know, thank you that you do it, but you don't have to, usher. Just keep coming to church, you know, let get ministered to, and just do what you got to do, amen? Because he just said, I know it's me. He said, I know it's me. It's just that it's long weeks. I get tired, and I hate, you know, and because he even looked at me and he goes, Pastor, I don't even want to come to church on Sundays. He says, I'm so tired. You know, I'm so tired. I just want to stay home and rest. And I said, well, hey, you do what you got to do. You know, I mean, my God, God's not going to hit you over the head. God's not going to do anything like that. Amen. You got to take care of yourself. You got to take. And if it's affecting your marriage, you need to do something about it. You need to do something about it. You know, deal with this. Take care of this. And, you know, here's the thing again, church. If we're not careful, if we don't deal with these things, understanding that God has made a way for us, understanding that God is there to help us, not just to judge us, not just to, like if you mess up, sometimes people just feel like God is waiting to hit them, spank them, or do something, but God isn't. God is ready to help you, hug you, love you, and help you, you know, get to where you need to be. Why? Because you have a calling on your life. That's what the enemy is trying to stop. He's trying to stop the calling on your life. He's trying to stop you from serving God, loving God, serving people, being, you know, being a representative of Christ. That's what he's trying to stop. He'd rather you're just giving up. You know, I don't know if I shared it in the dessert, but I've known people that have served God. I know people that have gone to Bible school, Rhema, graduated. They used to rejoice, you know, I used to rejoice with them, loving God, and now they're not even serving God anymore. I mean, I'm not saying they don't love God. I'm sure they do, but they're just not serving God anymore. And it breaks my heart to hear, you know, some of the things they're doing, some of the things that's going on in their lives. And I keep thinking, what drove them from where they were to where they're at now? And I truly believe it was just a flesh thing. Did not deal with it, did not do anything with it, and let it progress, that you get to the point you don't feel bad not being there anymore. I don't know about you, but if I haven't been in church one Sunday, if we're on vacation, but then the other, man, I can't wait to get into the house of God. But here's the thing. I serve God every day. Every day. God's not a Sunday God. God's an everyday God. Sunday isn't just the day we act spiritual. It's an everyday thing. That's how we walk. That's how we talk. That's how we live. Are we perfect? No. We gonna miss it? Sure. But you're gonna continue going. You're gonna continue doing. You're gonna continue serving. You're gonna continue loving. You're gonna continue doing what you know what to do. I love what Pastor shared today, because it is so true, church. Because when you go through struggles, I'm going to be very honest, that you know whose voice I hear of the word being spoken, like scriptures and stuff? It's my own voice. It's my voice speaking. I can hear my voice saying the things I'm saying right now. And it ministers to me. It speaks to me. Because why? It's the Word of God. 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 I haven't changed because I'm a great guy. I changed because of the Word of God. It just keeps changing you. Sometimes you're going to get to a place, you're going to look back and say, wow, how did I get here? God brought you. God brought you. Amen? And God's not done taking you. He's not done. Amen? Amen. Let's stand up. I've gone over. I'm sorry. I went over. Thank you, Lord. But I'll say this. If you're there and you feel you've been struggling, you've been going through some things, maybe, you know, something's been going on in your life and you know it's something that you need to make a change. Right now, I'm not going to ask you to come up here. Right where you're at, you start making that change. You look at it. You know, and you say, Lord, I don't know. You say, Lord, help me with my anger issues, Lord God. Help me with this, Father God. Help me with whatever it is you're going through. You ask God right now where you're at to help you with it. You don't need to let everybody know. But if you do need help, you do need someone to pray with you, we're going to have the prayers to come up and you can come and they'll pray with you. But let's pray. Father, we thank you, Lord God. We thank you, Lord, that you're so good, Father God. Father, you're always there for us, Father. You lead us, you guide us, you direct us, Father God. And Lord, even when we miss it, Father God, even when we miss it, Lord, you're always showing us. But we know we need to take our own responsibility to crucify the flesh, to say no when we need to say no, and to say yes when we need to say yes. And Father, we thank you that you are always showing us, you are always strengthening us, and we give you all glory, we give you all honor. And Father, I thank you that you just help in this area right now. I give it to you, Lord God, that you help me with this, Father. I acknowledge that I do have this fault, Father God, that I do give in to this. But I thank you that you, Lord, are helping me as I let it go. And I give you all glory, Lord God. I give you all power. And I, oh, thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. We give you all glory in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen, amen. We're going to go ahead and dismiss, but if anybody needs prayer, we want you to go ahead and come up. They're going to be here as we're dismissed. So turn to somebody and tell them, God is good, you look good, and we're going to see you next Sunday. Those that are pizza with the pastors, please go to your left to the youth building.
He was fulfilling prophecy. Everyone can see.